get your answers, and we're actually going to poll them live up here. And so you'll use the clickers to answer the questions, and it's totally anonymous, and we will actually do live polling up here. And so that's going to be after the presentation, and after that I can take any questions that you might have. Okay? All right, so just a brief history of white-tailed deer in the state of Texas. In the past, they were over-hunted, and believe it or not, they were nearly extirpated from the state of Texas. So by the end of the 19th century, we had very low numbers, and people began to take notice. And so they started to do something about it. And if you can imagine, it's really hard to believe, at one point, there were so few white-tailed deer that there were people in the state of Texas that had never seen a white-tailed deer before. So it's kind of hard to imagine. So, by the beginning of the 20th century, protective measures were put into place. So we had basically our first bag limits, okay, our first close season, and this wasn't just on white-tailed deer, but this was also on turkey as well, okay, so we started to see our first game laws be put into place. We started to sell our first hunting license. And we also, I believe it was in 1919, the state of Texas hired their first 6 game wardens for the entire state of Texas. So we had these game laws in place now, and now we needed somebody out there to actually enforce these laws, right? So they hired 6 game wardens to cover the entire state. So you can imagine enforcement was quite an issue at that point. I think today we have over 500 game wardens to cover the state. And then we had a trapping and restocking program. And that's what this photo indicates here. And this was a big deal. I mean, you can see all the people that turned out when they were basically releasing deer in the area. And so through all those efforts, we were very successful, obviously. Today there's an estimated 4 million white-tailed deer in the state of Texas. So in urban areas, we tend to see higher densities a lot of times. And people often wonder, well, why is that? It's not like it's great white-tailed deer habitat. And no, it's not necessarily great white-tailed deer habitat. However, white-tailed deer are highly reproductive, right? So most does have twins. Most of you probably know that, but sometimes that can be surprising for people to realize that most does will have twins. Every once in a while, triplets. There's a lot of supplemental feeding that goes on in urban and suburban areas, whether it's intentional supplemental feeding or unintentional. Unintentional would be something like planting, you know, a nice garden for the deer to come and frequent. Habitat loss, okay? So you would think, well, they're losing habitat, why are their numbers growing? Well, as it turns out, white-tailed deer are what we call habitat generalists. Meaning, they can do well in all different types of habitats. So even though it's not their preferred habitat, they can still survive and do okay. And it turns out that suburbs work out just fine for them, okay? So they can do just fine in suburban areas. There's also a lack of predators for them. So the main predator or the main cause of mortality for urban and suburban deer are vehicles. And typically in suburban areas, there's little to no hunting. And obviously, you know, depending on the area, there's ordinances in place, there's safety concerns and those type of things, so there's really little to no hunting in these areas. So a little bit about white-tailed deer biology. Their food habits, they require a relatively high protein diet. So at minimum, about 12% protein, but during certain times of the year, they're going to require higher amounts of protein in their diet. They rely primarily on forbs, or what we call forbs. They're basically broad-leaved flowering plants. So you can think of your weeds and wildflowers and those type of things. That's forbs. And they rely on woody browse species, so your trees and shrubs. And as it turns out, the deer population in the Edwards Plateau, or the hill country, is so high that we're actually not seeing any regeneration of some of these preferred deer browse species. So the photograph in here, this is a Spanish oak or a Texas red oak, and that's one of the preferred browse species for a white-tailed deer. We're not seeing any regeneration going on. So once those parent trees die, any little seedlings that come up get nipped right down to the ground by the white-tailed deer. And so it's a concern, especially for biologists. You can imagine in another 50, 70 years, really, the face of the hill country is going to start to change as some of these other species too, like cedar elm, Spanish oak, post oaks, things like that. We're not seeing any regeneration going on. So obviously, white-tailed deer require water, and they require cover. So they need dense cover from the elements, so from cold weather, from rain, but they also need that mid to tall grassy cover that they like to have for fawning cover. Reproduction. We are in reproduction season for white-tailed deer. We are in the rut now. For the Edwards Plateau, it's basically October through January, but for this area, the peak rut is the beginning of November, so we're approaching that now. So you've probably seen some bucks out there, Jason does, perhaps. Again, most does are going to end up producing twins. And the population in the Edwards Plateau shows an increasing trend over the last 30 years. So the population's been growing over the last 30 years. Couple of ecological terms. One is the biological carrying capacity, and this is one biologists use on a fairly regular basis, but all that means is it's the maximum number of individuals the habitat can support without that habitat being damaged. So we all know that nature has the ability to regenerate and replenish itself, right? But with too many mammals out there, too much pressure on the habitat, it's not able to do that all the time. And so when you reach a certain threshold or a certain population level, you've exceeded that carrying capacity, and so you've exceeded that biological carrying capacity, that habitat can regenerate itself. And again, that's kind of what we're seeing in the hill country now. So it comes to that saying basically that as that population approaches that biological carrying capacity, we start to see a reproduction or a decrease in reproduction and an increase in mortality. Theoretically, that's how it's supposed to work out. And under normal circumstances in a normal habitat, that's how it works out. But we have this other term now when we start dealing with urban deer called the cultural carrying capacity. And this is more often what we're dealing with when we talk about urban deer management. And that's basically the maximum number of individuals society will accept in a given area. And so this is usually the number we're kind of focused on in an urban and suburban type setting. And a lot of times that cultural carrying capacity is lower than the biological carrying capacity for many species. So you can think, you know, mountain lions, coyotes, people don't want large populations of those animals around, right? However, for white-tailed deer, it can be the opposite. That cultural carrying capacity can actually be higher than the biological carrying capacity. So when the deer population begins to grow, and it grows beyond that biological carrying capacity, especially in urban suburban areas, we start to see conflicts with deer. Okay, so one of the things we start to see landscape damage. And people start to complain about their landscape being eaten by the deer. Well, there's an estimated about $250 million in damage and landscape damage annually nationwide. All right, we also start to see an increase in deer vehicle collisions. So you can see here, in the last 10 years, deer vehicle collisions have jumped 33% in the state of Texas. And we also have issues with just human safety, okay? So we are in the rut season, and we are approaching peak rut. And this is the time of year where myself or some of the game wardens start to get calls about males acting aggressively towards people. Okay, because they are in the ruts, they're starting to act aggressively, and we get phone calls about concerned citizens because some of these males are starting to act aggressive even towards people. And then even during the fawning season, we get phone calls about does being aggressive. They're protecting their fawns, and usually the aggression is shown towards pets, particularly dogs, and we have had instances where dogs have gotten hurt because they've been attacked by a doe protecting her fawns. Then we also have diseases, and so the main disease that people are concerned about is Lyme disease. And so deer carry the black-legged tick, right? And the black-legged tick is a vector for Lyme disease. We do have Lyme disease here in Texas. It is not as prevalent in Texas as it is in other states in the Northeast, and the Northeast is very prevalent. But anytime you have an increase in deer, you're going to have an increase probably in the number of ticks in the area. And so, you know, people often get concerned about an increased chance of contracting Lyme disease. And studies have been mixed on this as to whether or not that's the case, but it's something to think about in the future. But also, not only Lyme disease, but think about disease spread among the deer themselves. So anytime you have large numbers of animals concentrated in a small area, it's the same thing for people too, you have an increased risk for the chance of spread of disease or parasites or anything like that. And we have a very serious disease out there now called chronic wasting disease that I'm sure a lot of you at this point have probably heard about. It's been detected now in the state of Texas for the last few years. And it's a very, it's 100% fatal. And basically, you know, anytime you have deer in close proximity, if you think about these deer, they are in close proximity to each other and they are eating where they're also defecating, which is not usual animal behavior, right? So there's a greater chance for the increase in spread of disease and parasites. So what do we do to try to reduce the conflict with the white-tailed deer, right? Because basically white-tailed deer are, they're a beautiful animal and they are a very important species. They're important recreationally, they're important economically, they're probably the most recognized species of wildlife out there. And so we don't want to have this conflict with the deer. We want to be able to appreciate the deer, but it's hard to do when you're experiencing conflict like that. And so basically, in urban deer management, it's basically trying to reduce that conflict. So step one, form a deer management committee or a wildlife management committee, or in your case, a commission. Survey the residents. Find out their opinions. What are their thoughts on this? Do they feel there are too many deer? Do they want something done about the deer management? What do they feel could be done about deer management? Get surveys that conduct basically a population estimate. And Garden Ridge has been doing this. I've worked with the city now for a couple of years, and they've been doing surveys every fall, every August, September, doing surveys, getting an estimate of the deer density. Basically, what those estimates are really good for, they're good to look at the trends. So what is that population doing over time? So it's just a glimpse of the population, right? It's an estimate, it's not an exact measurement, but the useful way, or the way to use that data most usefully would be to look at that trend line. So over time, is that population increasing? Is it decreasing, or is it staying the same? Then we have an idea of what that population is actually doing. Also keep track of things like collisions with vehicles. Okay, so how many deer vehicle collisions occur during a year within the city limits? Keeping track of landscape damage, all right? And basically, you know, educating the residents about some of these conflicts, keeping track of these numbers, because this is gonna measure your success. If you do implement, you know, an urban deer management program, these are the numbers you're gonna use to try to measure success. Do you have a reduction in the number of deer vehicle collisions? Do you have a reduction in the amount of landscape damage occurring? Those type of things. So what can you do to help prevent landscape damage? Well, you can try to plant deer-resistant plants. Okay? And I always do this with quotation marks because the resistance of that plant is going to depend on the size of that population and what is available to eat. So even plants that are labeled deer-resistant will be eaten by deer if populations get high enough and there's not enough to eat out there. Okay? But there are plants that are more deer resistant than others, and there's a very good resource out there. It's called Native and Adapted Landscape Plants. It's put out by AgriLife Extension in the city of Austin. So these are native plants, and in there it tells you if they are deer resistant or not. Okay, so it's a good resource to kind of go to if you're thinking about how to landscape your yard. Obviously, I'm sure some of you already do this, but put up some enclosures too around some of your sensitive plants that you have that you know the deer like. All right. Another option is to limit the feeding of deer. All right, so as you recall, I told you earlier that deer require about 12% protein in their diet, and even higher amounts during certain times of year. And so a lot of times people end up feeding them corn. Well, we refer to corn as beer for deer, Okay, it's a very high kind of carbohydrate diet, not good for them. Okay, it can result in things like acidosis and aflatoxin. Okay, so acidosis occurs anytime, like if a deer switches from a high fiber, now remember they're eating those woody plants, that's a high fiber diet, and they switch to predominantly corn, if they're getting fed a lot of corn at certain times of the year, then that's a very high carbohydrate diet, so that the switch between the high fiber to a high carbohydrate diet can actually disrupt the pH in their rumen. Okay, it leads to lactic acid buildup. It can disrupt the pH of their rumen, and it can harm the microorganisms that are doing all the work in there. It can lead to things like dehydration and other issues. Aflatoxin, that's caused basically by a fungus that grows on corn and peanuts. Okay, some of you have probably heard of this toxin before, but basically, you know, corn has some level of aflatoxin in it. The bagged corn that you buy to feed deer, it has some level of aflatoxin in it. And if the levels get too high, it can actually lead to issues with some of these deer, things like liver damage, anemia, cancer. And so that's another issue with feeding corn. And so basically, you know, making sure corn stays off the ground, clean and dry will help. But again, it's not a very nutritional supplement for their diet. Also, feeding deer habituates deer to people. And this is one, I mean, as a wildlife biologist, I want people to appreciate wildlife, because if they don't appreciate wildlife, I don't have a job, right? I don't have wildlife out there. They're not going to want to protect species. They're not going to want to protect habitat for wildlife species. So I want people to appreciate wildlife, but I also want people to appreciate wildlife for what they are. They're wild animals, and anytime you start to feed them, and if deer coming up to you eating out of your hand, that's really not a good thing. That's habituating a wild animal to a person, and that's when we start to see more conflict with these deer, right? That's when a wild animal loses its fear of humans, that's when we tend to see more conflict with those animals. Also, feeding deer can attract unwanted wildlife. So, you know, raccoons, right? You can attract raccoons. But one animal that you want to make sure you don't attract are feral hogs. And I know that, you know, I've been told that the city is experiencing some issues or starting to see some signs of feral hog activity. And this is a wildlife species that you really don't want to see around. They are a non-native animal. They cause a lot of destruction. And I mean, they can uproot a pasture in an entire night. I mean, everything will be fine one day, you wake up the next morning and everything's uprooted. They're also, you know, they contribute to bacterial loading in our waterways, right? They like to spend the days down, you know, wallowing where there's some water and mud. They'll root up around stream beds, creek beds, rivers. So they contribute to bank erosion, to bacterial loading, to turbidity in our waterways. And so they can be very destructive. And it's not an animal that you want to have to deal with, but we have about an estimated 2.6 million feral hogs in the state of Texas. We have them in every county except El Paso County, and for all I know, they've probably found them there now too. We have them in 36 states in the United States now, so and the populations are just growing. And the only thing we can really hope to do is manage them. At this point, we're not gonna be able to eliminate feral hogs. All right, sometimes hunting is an option, but obviously this isn't an option in every situation, okay? So obviously the main thing is to maximize human safety and to maximize humaneness and efficiency when it comes to hunting. Obviously city ordinances are gonna come into play here, as well as county ordinances. And so in Comal County, basically there's no hunting on properties that are 10 acres or less. There's two ordinances in place in Comal County. One prevents the discharge of a firearm on 10 acres or less. The other prevents the discharge of a bow on 10 acres or less. And so that pretty much prohibits any type of hunting on 10 acres or less. So through Parks and Wildlife, you can apply for two different types of permits. This is a long explanation. So the first one is called the TTT permit, which is basically the trap, transport, and transplant permits. All right, so this permit, there's a fee for this. I think it's about $750 for the permit. And basically, the deer are trapped, and they are taken and released at another site. Okay, and so basically, you hire a trapper to come trap the deer, and then they're relocated to another site. And ideally, if you can find a site to release these deer at, that's great. But I will say that it's very difficult nowadays to do that. One, because of the spread of CWD, landowners are afraid to take in deer because they don't want CWD on their property, right? And so there's fewer landowners that are willing to take in deer nowadays. The other issue is that that release site has to be approved by Texas Parks and Wildlife biologists. And so that biologist has to go out there and make sure that that site can withstand more deer. So to make sure that site is not already above its biological carrying capacity when it comes to deer. So that's difficult to do because most places already have too many deer. And so if the biologist says there's already too many deer out here, I see too much damage to the habitat to begin with, they're not going to allow more deer to be transplanted or transported to that site. And it also requires CWD testing, so 15 individuals, this is post-mortem testing, so 15 individuals need to be submitted for testing. And then there's the trap transport process, or the TTP permit. Okay, so this is where, again, the deer traps. So you hire a trapper, comes out, traps the deer taken to a processing facility, and the meat is donated to an approved charity. Okay, there's no fee for this particular permit. But again, CWD testing is required, so 15 individuals will have to be submitted and come back negative for CWD in order for this, you know, to take place. 15 deer. Right, for each trapping season, 15 deer, yeah.
Is this the test post-mortem?
The test is post-mortem, yeah. No, not in Cremont County. There's never been a positive CWD. The only positive CWD right now has been in, most of them have been in like high fence breeding facilities around Medina County. There was one last year, one free ranging white tailed deer that tested positive, and it was in Medina County. All right, and birth control, and I always bring this up too, because people are curious about it, and they want to know, is it an option or isn't it an option? And as of right now, it's no, it's not really an option. There's no approved birth control method by the state, okay? That's not to say that in the future there may not be, but there's more research that really needs to be done to see, are there ways to make it more effective than it currently is? So there's two forms of birth control. There's contraception, and then there's sterilization, okay? So contraception, for both of these forms of birth control, research has shown for it to be effective at controlling the population, you need to target and get about 80% of the females, or 80% of the does, okay? Because your reproductive potential lies in the does. Either contraception or sterilization to be effective, it has to be a relatively close population. So if you're out there trying to do this and you have more does coming in and you have more immigration coming in, it's not very effective, okay? So it has to be a relatively close population, and you need to target and try to get about 80% of the does for either one of these methods to be effective, okay? And it has shown to be effective in closed populations. There's been research out there to show that this can be effective in closed populations. But with the contraception, after about 2 years, it's only about 50% effective. Okay, so they need a booster, okay? So obviously sterilization is pretty much 100% effective the first time around, okay? The problem is that, remember, it requires about 80% of the does to be treated, and if you think about, I mean, you have to trap these does, okay? Because you have to deliver in hand, even contraception, you have to have that deer in hand to deliver it, okay? So if you think about trying to catch these does, well, the first does you catch, none of them have been treated yet, so yeah, you know, you can treat them all, but as you go on, and you treat the first 50% that you need to treat, works out great. Trying to get that last 50% of does that you need to treat can be more difficult because A, those are the does that are probably smarter, not as likely to go in the traps, okay? And B, you're trapping does that have already been treated. Okay, so it gets harder. There's more manpower involved, more hours required to try to get that last 50%. Does that make sense? And so that's part of the reason. So cost estimates can range up to $1,000 a deer. That is part of the reason, is because of the manpower involved to try to get that last like 50% of the does. But there's ongoing research, and one of the main groups doing research on this is called White Buffalo, and they're based out of New York. And they are basically, you know, they're trying to figure out and improve ways to use birth control for urban deer management. As more research is done, and maybe we figure out some better ways to do this, more effective ways, and maybe even more cost-effective ways to do this may become an option in the future.